Hachette Audio presents More Numbers Every Day. How data, stats, and figures control our lives, and how to set ourselves free. Micael Dahlen and Helge Thorbjørnsen. Translated by Paul Norlan. Read by Katie Koster with notes from the authors. They look so innocent sitting there, those numbers. A lone number on a screen or a piece of paper. Your account balance, your pulse, or the number of steps before lunch. 1,590, 97, 3,467. Numbers are so concrete, exact, and clear. Numbers don't lie. They're honest, controllable, and neutral. A rational, enlightened society is based on numbers, not emotions. Numbers provide transparency, reliability, and evidence. Numbers are relevant, rational, and objective. 0, 55, 7.9. So we thought. But instead, it turns out that they're flirtatious, manipulative, distracting little devils. 2, 4, 16. Numbers mislead us and lie. They distort and entice. They divide and command. They have slipped in everywhere you look and are in the process of taking over your life. You love them. You depend on them. And they're in the process of really messing things up for you. You just don't know it yet. 1, 2, 3. Foreword. Our days are numbered. Literally. Everything we do during the day is counted. The days we socialize, the days we exercise, the days we work, study, travel, the nights we sleep. Our phones, social media, email, and apps count it all up day by day. How many steps have you taken today? How many friends do you have? How good is the driver in that car you ordered and are about to get into? What used to be called a taxi back in the day. You know all that because there are numbers for it. The pedometer counts the steps for you. Facebook counts your friends for you. The rideshare app calculates the average score of the driver for you. Just a few years ago, you had no idea. But today, there are counters for everything you do in a day. And at night, too, for that matter. If you want to know how long you've slept, how deeply, and how many times you woke up, snored, or turned over in bed, or were social, there are counters for that too. Search counter in the App Store and you'll get blisters from scrolling before you reach the end of the list. Do a Google search for counter apps and you'll get over 1 million hits. All those counters are a symptom that something is happening with our lives. Not too long ago, we managed to get through the day just fine without knowing how many steps we'd taken. We got along well with our friends without counting them. But just as soon as we had numbers for such things, those numbers suddenly became important to us. We started thinking about those numbers, feeling pleased by them, worrying about them, comparing them, and evaluating ourselves by them. They got us to take more steps, make more friends, get stressed about our low sleep numbers, and presumably lose even more sleep because of that. As if our lives depended on it. This development is epidemic. We find ourselves in a place where numbers work their way more and more into our lives, into everything we do and are, influencing how we behave, what decisions we make, and how we think, sense, and feel. Through the centuries, we humans have been programmed to automatically, instinctively react to numbers. Even if we truly wanted to stop using them, we probably wouldn't be able to. We are number animals. We have the same basic instincts as other animals, but what separates us from apes and cats, for example, is that our animal instincts are coded with numbers, even at the cellular level, as you will see. However, human evolution probably didn't count on our having to deal with as many or as large numbers as we do now. According to estimates, We now generate collectively more numbers every day than all humankind combined scraped together between the creation, more than 5,000 years ago, of the first clay tablet in Uruk and 2010. More numbers every day. What is that actually doing to us? We, Micael and Helge, started asking ourselves that question more and more often as we lectured and did research together about people's lives, behaviors, motivations, and happiness. We decided to find the answer, or more precisely, the answers in the plural. We have devoted several years to investigations, surveys, laboratory experiments, field studies, tests, interviews, and observations, and we have compiled the often rather startling results in this book. Here you are going to find out how numbers affect you physically, to the extent that they get you to age slower or faster, how numbers affect your self-image and make you feel better or worse, how they color your experiences, even influencing how you feel pain. We're also going to show how numbers have come to determine how you perform and how they have even wheedled their way into your relationships. Some effects are positive. For example, numbers actually get you to perform better. Quite a few are bad. For example, you care less about what you're actually performing in. Some are slightly unpleasant. For example, numbers can make you clinically depressed. And many of them are funny. For example, certain numbers make you more inclined to turn left. Our hope is that this book will help you to become aware of all of these effects so that you can take the good into account, counteract the bad, and hopefully never need to experience the unpleasant. So that you feel more content, have more fulfilling experiences, get more out of your relationships. Your partner, current or future, is going to thank you. And live a healthier life. You are also going to get some good stories to tell. About how a certain jersey number was required for Michael Jordan to become the GOAT, that is, the greatest of all time, as basketball aficionados say, how step counters can create a housing bubble, why the probability of getting a parking ticket is much higher right before Christmas than during the rest of the year, how a book about the genetics of flies became the world's most expensive within the course of 24 hours, or what Jesus and Kim Jong-il have in common, and how this has affected millions of people's lives. But wait, there's more, as they used to say on the TV shopping channels. We are also going to look more closely at how the number epidemic affects us not just as individuals, which itself has a big impact, but as an entire society. Numbers have also worked their way more and more into politics. As soon as it became possible for politicians to get numbers on how many people saw and internalized their message, they started adapting the message in real time to get those numbers as high as they could, maximizing their crowd appeal, making more promises, being more provocative, and acting more and more like caricatures. Build walls, or in any event, promise, threaten to do so, instead of bridges. You probably know whom we're referring to. Donald Trump was a clear symptom of the number epidemic. The campaign that made him president was led by numbers, as algorithms guided the message based on what produced the most clicks and shares. Numbers become a truth that influences decisions on all possible levels in society, both in companies and in the public sector. Things that are easier to measure get prioritized, like the strength of the lighting in a workplace instead of the employee's well-being, to take a funny example we'll come back to. For us, as professors of economics, it also seems obvious to point out that increasing access to numbers is in the process of making them a currency in themselves, a currency we can exchange with one another and with which we can trade and bargain. Likes, swipes, scores and points are all types of useful behavioral data. In one regard, we can see this as a positive, a possible alternative to money, with the potential to even out the differences between poor and rich and give everyone the chance to create their own capital, making it profitable, for instance, to be kind, have friends, and share. But what happens when the numbers simply become a new sort of money, with all its flaws, too? When it suddenly becomes possible to put a price on friendship? Buy and sell likes? The risk is that we will become number capitalists, greedy for more and bigger numbers, or even that we will act in immoral ways. Amusingly, one of our studies shows that people who get an unusually large number of likes on an Instagram picture also become more inclined to steal printer paper at work. We are going to show how numbers can make us depressed, narcissistic, and immoral, but also motivated, strong, and enthusiastic. You will learn how certain numbers stick in your brain and unconsciously influence what you are willing to pay for a house, a car, or a bottle of wine. And we're going to explain how we humans sometimes relate to numbers as if they had a personality and gender all their own. Numbers can be dangerous, but also amazing. And our goal is not to get you to stop using them. We, of course, love numbers. Otherwise, we never would have survived so long as economics professors. They're one of humanity's most important inventions. The first thing people considered worth writing down at all, according to archaeologists. The world's first known text is a clay tablet, excavated in what was once Mesopotamia, and dated to 3200 BC, accounting for the number of goods and assets of different types in the temple of the capital Uruk. A sort of Excel spreadsheet in clay, in other words. Since then, numbers have followed us through history, not only in accounting, but also in culture, religion, language, time, and civilization. But in recent years, our use of numbers has exploded. Have we been number-fied? Exponential technological development has made it possible for us to generate numbers to a much larger extent than just a few years ago. The calculating power in our computers has increased 60 to 100 times since just 2010, according to the top 500 list. That means that, following Moore's law, it has increased by a magnitude of 20 to 200% every single year for the past 50 years, depending on how you count it. Just 3 decades ago, capacity corresponding to the computers we have in our hands, which are called phones nowadays, would have cost over $100,000. We can fill these phones with calculators and apps, and there are computer systems, servers, and clouds that can register.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.